Guten Abend. Welcome. You're all very welcome to Juno and the Peacock from Sean O'Casey. This is a very special company. They've only done about 6.5 rehearsals, although they tell me it was 5 or 4. I don't know. But they've done about 5 times the show, 5 times rehearsed. And so some of them are going to be off the book. None of them are carrying books, and some of them aren't carrying books. It's how it goes. We have a laboratorium theatre here. It's a sort of a workshop theatre company. We did different productions. We did James Joyce, Ulysses, and Undermilk Wood. Now, what must I remember to tell you? Yes, Sean O'Casey's so interesting. He was born in 1880, and he was a manual labourer till the age of 41, living with his old mother, whose this play is about, basically. And when he became famous, he gave up working digging roads, and he suddenly became a famous writer. He was then thrown out by the Irish because he was very critical of certain things, which you're going to probably see in the play. And then he went and lived abroad, like Joyce and all those forever. Never went back. The play is in 3 acts. It's going to be quick because it's a long play, so I mustn't waste too much time. We've got 3 acts. After the first act, we're going to have a break, and then the second act and the third act run into each other. Okay? Have a very nice time.
On the Little By Road, down beyond Finglas, he was found.
Isn't he come in yet?
No, Mother.
Oh, he'll come in when he likes, I suppose. Strutting around town like a peacock with that jock, sir, I suppose. Oh, I hear all about Mrs. Tancred's sons in this morning's paper.
Ah, the full details are in this morning. 7 wounds he had, one entering the neck, with an exit wound in its left shoulder blade, another in the left breast, penetrating his heart.
Oh, quit that reading, for God's sake! You're just losing all your feelings. This wouldn't be none of you to read anything that's not about butchering.
He's getting very sensitive all of a sudden.
Well, I'll read all about it myself, by and by, Mary, when I come in later. Although everyone's saying that he was a diehard. Thing, really. May thanks be to God that Johnny's had nothing to do with him this long time past. Oh no. If that father of yours doesn't come in soon for his breakfast, he'll go without any, because I'll not wait much longer.
Can't you let him get it himself when he comes in?
Yes. And let him bring in that Joxer Daly along with him. Aye, that's what he'd like. And that's what he's waiting for. Till he thinks I've gone to work. And then He'll sail in with that old ball jock, sir. And he'll burn all the coal and drink all the tea in the place just to show them what a good Samaritan he is. Well, I'll wait here till he comes in, if I have to wait until tomorrow morning.
Mother!
Yes?
Bring us in a drink of water.
Bring that fella in a drink of water, for God's sake, Mary.
And isn't he big and able enough to go out and get it himself?
And if you weren't well yourself, you'd like somebody to bring you in a drink of water. Oh, isn't it terrible to be waiting this way? You'd think he was bringing £20 a week into the house the way that he's going on. He wore out the health insurance long ago. He's after wearing out the unemployment dole, and now he's trying to wear out me. And constantly singing, no less, when he ought to be always on his knees offering up a novena for a job.
I don't like his ribbon, love. I think I'll wear the green. It looks much better than the blue.
Wear whatever ribbon you like, girl. Just don't be bothering me. See, I don't know why a girl on strike wants to be wearing a ribbon around her head. Or silk stockings on her legs, either. It's wearing them things that makes the employers think they're giving you too much money.
But he always passed that matter that we asked for employers' permission to wear whatever we like.
And I don't know why he's wanted to walk out for Jenny Claffey. I mean, up to this, you never had a good word for her.
What's the use of belonging to a trades union if you won't stand up for your principles? Why did they sack her? It was a clear case of victimisation. You couldn't let her walk the streets now, could we?
No, of course you couldn't. You wanted to keep her company. One victim wasn't enough. When the employers sacrifice one victim, the trade unions have to go one better and sacrifice 100.
It doesn't matter what you say, Mum. A principle's a principle.
Yes. And when I go in to Al Murphy's tomorrow, and he gets to finding out that instead of paying all, I'm going to borrow more, what's he going to say when I tell him a principal's a principal? What'll we do if he doesn't give us any more on tick?
He daren't refuse. Even if he does, can't you tell him he's paid?
Well, it's looking like he's paid, whether he refuses or no.
I was lying down, our touches were gone out. Old Simon Mackey's driving me mad. He's tramping about like a horse over my head and I can't sleep with him. Curse him. God forgive me for going to curse.
Oh, there now. Go back and lie down again and I'll bring you in a nice cup of tea.
Tea, tea, tea. You're always thinking of tea. If a man was dying, you tried to have him swallow a cup of tea.
I don't know what's to be done with the fella. The bullet he got in the hip in Easter week was bad enough. But the bomb that shattered his arm in the fight in O'Connell Street put the finishing touch into him. Didn't I tell him that he was mad? Didn't I go down on my bended knees to him to beg him not to go against the Free States?
He stuck to his principles. And no matter how you may argue, Ma, a principle's a principle.
Is Mary going to stay here?
No, I'm not going to stay here. You can't expect me to always be at your back and call, can you?
I won't stop here by myself.
Oh, aren't I nicely handicapped by the hole he is? I don't know what any of you should do without your ma. Well, your father will be back in a minute, and if you want something, he'll get it for you.
I hate asking him for anything. He hates to be asked to stir. Is the light lighting before this picture of the Virgin?
Yes, yes. Oh, the one in sight to St. Anthony isn't enough. He must have another one to the Virgin here.
Oh, Mrs. Boyle, where's the captain?
You might ask the body that. He'll be drinking in some snug or another with Jock, sir.
Father Farrell was just up to stopping to tell me to get him to go to the new job that's going on in Rathmines. His cousin's the foreman on the job there, and he was speaking to him about poor Johnny and his father being idle so long. And if I get him to run up there, and then he might get a start. Where would I find him?
You'd find he's either in Ryan's or Foley's.
I'll pop around to Ryan's then. He knows a good house of Jocks's.
He'll lose that job or I'll know for what. Oh, if he hears one of the word of it, he won't be home until evening and that's just to be too late. there'll never be any good got out of him as long as he goes around with that shoulder-shrugging joxer. And I'm working day and night, and he's just gallivanting around the town like a peacock.
Sweet spirit, hear me pray, hear me pray, hear me pray, sweet spirit, hear me pray.
Oh, that's a darling song, a darling song.
Sweet spirit, hear his prayer. I'll take me solemn affidavit it's not for a job that he's praying.
Come on in, Joxer. Nobody here, man. There's nothing else we'd forage on a cup of tea anyway. You know, it's the only comfort I get when she's away these days. Didn't you know she should be called at all, but dear to the sorrows? She's always grousing.
Oh, it's a terrible thing to be married to a woman that's always grousing. We don't know where we stick it. It'd put years on me. It's a good job she has to be so often away. For when the cat's away, the mice can play.
Come on, sit down there and we'll have a cup of tea in a minute.
A cup of tea is a darling thing. A darling thing. The cup that warms but doesn't inebriate.
Oh, sit down by the fire, Joxer Daly, and we'll have a cup of tea in a minute. Are you sure you wouldn't like an egg?
Oh, I can't stop, Mrs. Boyle. I'm in a desperate hurry, a desperate hurry.
Oh, no. Pull up to the fire, Joxer Daly. People find their place here far more comfortable than their own places.
Hey, Joxer.
Yes?
You know the foreman of that job going down in Killester, don't you?
Foreman? Killester?
He's a buddy of yours, isn't he?
Oh, yes. The foreman at Killester. He's an old buddy of mine. Oh, he's a darling man. A darling man.
So it's a sure thing then. If we'd gone down to breakfast, we'd have started by now.
Better
but
late.
You didn't know that then, did you?
It's better late than ever.
About time we got to start. We were a long time waiting for it. He promised you. Gave you the straight tip.
Yes. Come down on the blow of dinner, says he, and I'll start you and any friend you might like to bring with you. Says I, you're a darling man. A darling man.
Well, couldn't come at a better time. We're a long time waiting for
Indeed we were, but it's a long lane that has no turning.
The blow for dinner's at one now.
Mind how you go on tinkering with that clock. You know the slightest thing sets it straight.
It's a great time we got the job anyhow. The legs are good on me now. Last week I was crippled by them.
Ah, that's better and better. God never shut one door, but he opened another.
Do you know, it's 11 o'clock. We got lashings of time. I'll put on my moleskin trousers and we can saunter down at our ease. Might as well bring the shovels with us, huh?
It's better to go fully prepared and ready for all eventualities. You bring your long-tailed shovel and I'll bring me navvy. We mightn't want them, but then again, we might. For want of a nail, the shoe was lost. For want of a shoe, the horse was lost. For want of a horse, the man was lost. Oh, that's a darling proverb. A darling proverb.
We'll be all right after a few weeks, sir. When I'm on the job a few weeks. You know, the foreman at a job is a buddy of Jox's. I've a feeling I know him myself. There's a button missing off the back of me moleskin trousers. If you leave out the needle and try to sew it on myself. The legs are fine now. Last week they were killing me.
Now look here, Mr. Jackie Boyle. If you think those yarns are going down with Juno, you're... No. I know you and Jox are an old deed. And if you think you can comment over me with them fairy tales, you're in the wrong shop.
Butty Joxers.
Oh, you'll do a lot of good as long as you continue to be a butty at Joxers. And a shovel. Listen, me boy. You'd do more work with a knife and fork than you'll ever do with a shovel. If there was ever a genuine job opportunity coming around, you'd be the other way around. Not able to lift your arms for the pains in your legs. And your wife slaving to keep the bit in your mouth and you're just gallivanting around like a peacock.
Ought to be better for a man to be dead. Better to be dead.
And everybody calling you captain. And you only once on the water, and then I'll carry her from here to Liverpool. And anybody to look at her, to listen to you, would think you're a second Christopher Columbus.
Are you ever going to give it a rest?
And you're never tired of looking for a rest.
Do you want to drive me out of the house?
It would be easier to drive you out of the house than to drive you into a job. Now, sit down and take your breakfast. It may be the last one you're going to get, because I don't know where the next one's coming from.
We'll be all right again after a few weeks.
Now, did you see Cherry Devine?
No, I didn't see him.
Well, if you'd been in for your breakfast, you would have seen him. He was looking for you.
Oh, well, let him look.
Indeed, for it'd be hard for him to find you and you stuck in Ryan's Snug with Jockser.
I don't go to Ryan's Snug, I don't drink in Ryan's anymore.
Is there a mad dog in there? Well, if you weren't in Ryan's, you were in Foley's.
Look, I haven't tasted a drop of intoxicating liquor in about 3 weeks. I am as innocent as a child unborn.
Well, if you'd have been here, you would have seen him.
Well, what did he want?
Well, he'll be back in a minute, and then you'll soon know.
I'll go and see if I can find him myself,
you'll sit down and take your breakfast, and then let me go off to work for an hour late already, waiting for you.
Look, I'll take no breakfast. I've got spirit in me still.
Do you want your breakfast? Yes or no?
No, I don't want my breakfast. You can keep your breakfast. I've got spirit in me still.
Well, nobody will coax you. Don't think that.
Oh, I've got spirit still.
Oh, here you are at last. I've been searching for you everywhere. The foreman at Foley's told me you hadn't left the Snug with Jockser 10 minutes before I came in.
And him swearing on the holy prayer book that he wasn't in no Snug.
What business is it of yours whether I'm in his Snug or no? You follow me around. Can a man not leave his house for a minute without a load of spies, pimps and informers cantering at his heels?
Oh, you're taking a wrong view of it, Mr. Boyle. I was simply anxious to do you a good turn. I've got a message for you from Father Farrell. He says if you go off to the new job that's going on in Rathmines and speak to Foreman Mangan, you'll get a start.
Look, that's all right, but I don't want you following me. Like an astronomer, it'd be after stars. If you're after Mary itself, that's okay with me. Oh, the right leg is killing me now.
Oh, it won't be long now till it moves over to your left one. It's a miracle that when he sniffs a genuine job opportunity, his legs begin to fail him.
Yeah, and this job will last for some time too, Captain. Once the foundations are in, it'll be cushy enough.
Well, what if I have to climb up a ladder? And if I climb up there itself, how am I going to get back down?
Get one of the labourers to bring you down in a hood. Oh, you're not able to climb up a ladder, but you're able to skip like a goat into a Snug.
Yeah, and I wouldn't let myself be let down that easy, Mr. Boyle. A little bit of exercise, that'll do you all the good in the world.
Do you know, it's a doctor, you should have been divine. You seem to know more about the pains in me legs than has in myself.
I know nothing about the pains in your legs. Look, I brought the message that Father Farrell gave me, and that's all I can do.
So, sit down and take your breakfast and stop acting like you couldn't pull the wings off a dead bee.
Look, I'll have no breakfast. After all that's been said, I've got spirit to me still.
Well, let's see some of that spirit then. Go in and put on your wolf moleskin trousers and...
Oh, it'd be better for a man to be dead. Better to be dead. Oh, God, the other leg. Oh, the pains I'm in with these legs lately.
I must rush off for an awful late already. I'm determined to stay and hunt that Jockser this time.
You going out again, Mary?
It looks like it when I'm putting on my hat, doesn't it?
It's a bitter word again, Mary.
You won't allow me to be friendly with you. I tried. You deliberately misunderstand it.
I didn't always misunderstand it. You're often delighted to have the arms of Jerry around you.
If you go on talking like this, Jerry Devine, you'll make me hate you.
Well, there'll either be a wedding or a wake. Listen, Mary. I'm standing for the secretaryship of our union. There's only one opposing me. I'm popular with all the men, and a good speaker. All the same, I'll get elected.
Well?
The job's worth £350 a year, Mary. You know I could live nice and cosily on that. Could lift you out of this place.
I haven't the time for this, Jerry. I have to go.
What's come over you with me for the last few weeks? You hardly speak to me. I'm only a word with a face of bitterness on it. Have you forgotten, Mary? All the happy evenings are as sweet as a scented hawthorn that shelter the sides of the road as we saunter through the countryside.
That's all over now, Jerry. When you get your new job, you won't be long finding a girl far better than I am for your sweetheart.
Never. Never, Mary. Whatever happens, he'll always be the same to me.
I haven't the time for this. Let me go.
Can I go a bit of the way with you?
You needn't, thanks. I want to be by myself.
You're going to meet another fella. You clicked with somebody else, m'lady.
That's no concerns of yours, Jerry Devine. Now let me go.
I saw you coming out of the Cornerflower dance class, and you hanging on his arm, a thin, lanky strip of a Mickey Dazzler with a walking stick and gloves.
What are you doing there, pulling about everything?
I'm putting on me moleskin trousers.
You're hurting me arm. Now let me go, or I'll scream. And then you have that old fella out on top of us.
Just give us one kind word, Mary. Just one kind word.
Just let me go. Let me go.
What's all this hullabaloo about?
Let me go.
Don't be so hard on the fella, Mary. Don't
What's
be so
all hard. This hullabaloo about?
Give me a kiss of white hand. Your tiny little white hand.
Your tiny little white hand? Have you taken leave of your senses, man? This is nice carry on in front of a father.
Try up, for God's sake.
Oh, chiselers these days. They bring grey hair down on top of their fathers and take the sorrow with them to the grave. The whole world's in a terrible state of chassis. Breakfast. Well, although the tea is wet right enough.
Robin's nest again, and the flowers they are in bloom. When springtime's sunny smile seems to banish all sorrow and gloom, then me bonny blue-eyed lad, if me heart be true to them, he's promised he'll come back to me when the robin's nest again. When the robin's nest again.
You'd not be wanting a sewing machine by any chance, would you?
No, I don't want a sewing machine.
All right.
When the robin's nest again. And the flower.
That's a terrible Sahara. That's a stranger. That's no one belonged to this house.
Did you hear them tattoos?
Joshua, I'm not deaf.
Who's that at the door? Who's that at the door? Who gave that knock? Do you hear me? Are you deaf or drunk or what?
Joshua, stick your head out the window there and see who's that.
And maybe get a bullet in the kisser. Nah, none of them tricks for Joxer. It's better to be a coward than a corpse.
It's a fella in a trench coat.
Oh, holy mother of God.
He's going away. He must have got tired of knocking. Yeah, sit down there, Joxer.
Well, I'm afraid the missus had pop in at us before we know where we are. Something's telling me to go at once.
Well, let her hop in, man. We're Dublin men, not boys up from the Bog of Allen. Although she did walk in enough, we'd get caught like rats in a trap.
And you know this Archie is, she wouldn't listen to reason.
Do you know, if the worst came to the worst, you could pop out here and just stay here outside the window, and then I'd give you the bin and you can run away if she comes.
I won't stop very long, anyhow. Here's his Dubuque.
Ah, it's one of Mary's. She's reading a lot lately. Rubbish mostly. She was reading three stories the other day. The Doll's House, Ghosts and The Wild Duck. Books only fit for chiselers.
Did you ever read Elizabeth or The Exile of Siberia? Oh, it's a darling story. A darling story.
Ah, go on. Have a sausage, man. We'll get to Exile of Siberia.
What are you wearing your moleskin trousers for?
Devine came in now and he's telling me Father Cowell's got a job down in Rat Mines.
Be the holy, that's good news.
How's that good news?
I thought.
You thought what? You think sometimes too much, Jackson.
How is it good news? I wonder if you were in my condition, would you call it good news?
Well, I forgot about the pains in your legs. I know you can do nothing when they're at you.
You know, you forgot. I think none of yous realise the pain I'm in with these legs of mine. What would happen if I had to carry a bag of cement?
I know. Any man having the likes of them pains would be down and out. Down and out.
You know, I wouldn't mind if you had said it to myself. But he comes running in here in front of Juno, and you know what Juno's like. Well, Divine knows a bit more than the rest of us. But he doesn't show it. He's well able to talk, but still.
Oh, I able to argue for you, but still.
You know, if he's running after Mary himself, he's not running after me. Captain Boyle can take care of himself. After all, I'm not getting brought up in Virro. You know, I've never heard him curse at all. I don't think he's ever had a drink in his life, or he's never seen him drunk. Do you know, he's not a Christian at all.
You're after taking the words right out of me mouth. After all, a Christian's natural, but he's unnatural.
His old fellow was the same, a Wicklow man.
A Wicklow man? Ha! That explains the whole thing. I've met many a Wicklow man in me time, but I've never met one that was any good.
Father Farrell, says he, send me down. Father Farrell, you know, I don't like to be beholden to any of the clergy.
Oh, that's dangerous, right enough.
You know, if they did anything for you, they'd want you to be living in the chapel.
Well, I'm going to tell you something, Jocks, that I wouldn't tell anybody else. The clergy's always had too much power in this unfortunate country.
Oh, you could sing that if it had an air to it.
Didn't they hold the corn back from the people in 47? Didn't they down Parnell? Didn't they say hell was too hot and eternity too long enough to punish the Fenians? Oh, we don't forget them things, Jock, sir. If there's nothing else they've left us our memory.
For memory's the only friend that grief can call its own. That grief can call its own.
You know, Father Farrell's beginning to take a great interest in Captain Boyle because of what Johnny did for his country. Well, it's a great way to pay his old father back for what Johnny did for his country by getting him work. So I can work, day and night, mewling morning and night, till they're in better fettle when they come round collecting their dues. Job? Well, you know, he can give his job to one of his hymn-singing, craw-thumping confraternity men.
Lots, cold blocks.
God be with the young days when you were stepping the deck of a manly ship with the wind blowing a hurricane through the masts and the only sound you'd hear was "Port your helm!" and the only answer, "Port it is, sir."
You know, them was the days, Jock, sir. Them was the days. Nothing was too hot or too heavy for me then. Sailing from the Gulf of Mexico to the Antarctic Ocean, I seen things that no man should speak about that knows his catechism. Often and often, when I was tied to the wheel with a marlin spike, and the winds lashing, and the waves lashing and lashing, till you think every minute was going to be your last. And as it blowed and blowed, blue is the right word for it, but blown is what sailors use.
Oh, it's a daring word.
And as it blowed and blowed, I often looked up to the sky and asked myself the question, what is the stars? What is the stars?
Any blokes? Cold blokes? Blokes? Cold blokes?
That's the question. What is the stars?
And then again, I'd take another look and I'd ask myself, what is the moon?
That's the question. What is the moon? What is the moon? Oh!
Do you want any blocks?
No, we don't want any blocks.
Oh. Be the holy, I thought Juno would just come in.
Let her come in, man. We can't be just doing what she wants all the time.
The Them sentiments does you credit, Captain. I don't like to say anything as between man and wife, but I'm telling you as buddy to buddy that you've stuck it too long, and it's about time you showed a little spunk. How can a man die facing better than fearful odds for the ashes of his fathers and the temples of his gods?
You know she has her rights, but I have my rights too.
Of course you do, the sacred rights of man.
And from now on, there's going to be, I'm going to issue a proclamation establishing an independent republic, and Juno's going to have to take an oath of allegiance.
Be firm, Captain, be firm. The first few minutes will be the worst. If you gently touch a nettle, it'll sting you for your pains. Grasp it like a lad of metal, and soft as silk remains.
Can't stop, Mr. Oh, Jesus.
Yes, she knew that fella had stopped if she was in talking of us.
Oh, you're here. You must be only after coming in.
Oh, I never went out.
Well, strange then that you didn't hear the knocking.
Of course I heard the knocking.
Well, why didn't you open the door? Oh, were you too busy with Joxer?
Joxer, what have you doing, Joxer? I haven't seen Joxer since the last time I've seen him.
Well, you mean to tell me that the two of yous were colluding here behind my back?
Listen, what would I be colluding with Joxer? I have more things to be doing than just colluding with him.
Anyway, there's a visitor coming up with Mary. I mean, go in and take off your moleskin trousers and put on your collar and tie and smarten yourself up. Because there's a visitor coming up with Mary in a moment and he's got great news for you.
Yeah, a job, I suppose. Well, let me get one first before I get another.
That's the thing that'll put the wind up you. Well, it's not about a job. It's news that'll give you the chance of your life.
What's all this mystery about?
Go in and take off your moleskin trousers. Oh, oh God. Look at the way the things are thrown about in here. Joxer was here.
Please don't put yourself to any trouble, Mrs. Boyle. I'm quite all right here, thank you.
Oh, good. You must, Lyme?
I didn't think of you knowing Mary.
Oh, and to think of you knowing Mary, and she knowing the news that she had for us and not letting on. Well, it's all the more welcome right now, because we're on our last lap.
What are you kicking up all the racket for?
I'm taking off me moleskin trousers.
Well, can't you do it then without letting the whole house know you're taking off your trousers? What do you want putting them on and taking them off again?
Oh, will you let me alone? Will you let me alone? Am I never going to be done trying to please the whole of you?
You must excuse the state of the place, Mr. Bentham. The minute my back is turned, that man of mine makes a litter of the place. A litter of the place.
Don't worry, Mrs. Boyle. I'm all right, I can assure
you. Where's me braces? Where in the name of God did he leave me braces? How did you see where I put me braces?
Ma, will you come in here and take Diane away out of this or he'll drive me mad?
Dear, 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 that man of mine will be looking for something on the Day of Judgment. Would you look at your braces, ma? They're hanging around your neck.
Oh, holy God.
Johnny, come out here a minute.
Ah, leave Johnny alone and don't be annoying him.
Johnny, come out here a minute till I introduce you to Mr. Bentham. Oh, me son, Mr. Bentham, he's after going through the wars. He was only a chiseler of a Boy Scout when he got hit in the hip in Easter week. And then his arm got blew off in the fight in O'Connell Street. Oh, here he is, Johnny, Mr. Bentham. No one can say he hasn't done his bit for Ireland. Not that it's going to do him any good.
We'll do it again, Ma. We'll do it again. A principle's a principle.
Aye, and you lost your best principle, me boy, when you lost your arm. It's the only kind of principles that's any use to a working man.
Ireland only half free will never be at peace while she's a son left to pull a trigger.
To be sure, to be sure. And no bread is better than half a loaf. Will you hurry up in there? Oh, Mr. Boyle.
Glad to finally meet you, Mr. Boyle.
Hello, Mr. Bentham.
How are you doing?
Not too well at all. The pains in my legs are awful altogether.
You won't worry too much about the pains in your legs when you hear what Mr. Bentham has to say.
Juno, what an interesting name. It reminds me, One of Homer's glorious stories of ancient gods and heroes.
Yeah, Juno, isn't it? You know, Juno was born in June and christened in June. I met her in June. We got married in June. Johnny was born in June. So I said, we'll call you Juno, and it's stuck to her since.
We can talk about them things again later. Let Mr. Bentham see what he's got to say.
All right, Mr. Boyle. I suppose you are familiar with a certain Mr. Allison from Santry? Oh. He's a relative of yours, I think.
Yeah, he's an old prognosticator and a provocateur.
Well, he's dead, Mr. Boyle.
Sorry, there won't be many missing him.
Wait till you hear what Mr. Bentham has to tell you, and you might change your opinion.
A week before he died, he sent for me to write his will for him. There are only two people he wanted to leave his property to. His second cousin, Michael Finnegan of Santry, and Jack Boyle, his first cousin of Dublin.
Me? Me? Me?
You, Mr. Boyle. I'll read a copy of the will that I have here with me, which has been duly filed in the Court of Probate. 6th of February, 1922. This is the last will and testament of William Allison of Santry, in the county of Dublin. I hereby order and wish my property to be sold and divided as follows. £20 to the St. Vincent de Paul Society, £60 for masses for the repose of my soul, 5 shillings for each mass. The rest of my property to be divided between my first and second cousins. I hereby appoint Timothy Buckley of Santry and Hugh Brierly of Coolock to be my executors. Signed by William Allison, Hugh Brierly, Timothy Buckley, and Charles Bentham, national teacher.
How would you become your lord?
Well, the executors told me that half of the property would be anything between 1,500 and £2,000.
It's a fortune, Father. A fortune.
We'll be able to get away from here and go somewhere we're not known.
And you won't have to worry about a job for a while now, Jack.
Oh, I'll never doubt the goodness of God again.
I congratulate you, Mr. Boyle.
You'll have a wet.
A wet?
A bowl, a jar, a wet.
Jack, you're talking to Mr. Bentham now, not to Jock, sir.
Juno, Mary, Johnny, we'll have to go into mourning at once for poor Bill. You know, any of us could die, you today, Juno, and me tomorrow. But, requisat in pace. Or as St. Patrick or St. Bridget would say, gusera ni era.
Oh, Father, that's not rest in peace. That's God save Ireland.
Ah, it doesn't matter. It's a prayer, anyhow. I'm done with Joxer. You know, Joxer's nothing but a prognosticator and a procrastinator.
Oh. You're done with Joxer, are ya? Maybe you thought I'd stay out in the roof all night waiting for ya. Joxer out in the roof with the wind blowing through him was nothing to you and your friend in the tolerant eye.
What in the name of God brought you out? What were you doing out there on the roof?
I was dreaming I was standing on the bridge of a ship, and she sailing the Antarctic Ocean. And as it blowed and blowed, blew is the right word. As it blowed and blowed, and me saying, what is the stairs? What is the stairs?
Come on out of here, Joxer. I always thought you had a slate off.
I have to laugh every time I look at a deep sea sailor and a row in the river and make him seasick.
Hey, get over here, you. Get over here.
Say au revoir, but not goodbye. Looking for work and pray to God he doesn't find us.
I am tired of telling you what kind Joxer is. Perhaps now you'll see it for yourself.
Well, he'll never wipe the froth off another pint of mine. Mary, Johnny, from now on, we keep to ourselves. We control the whole thing. Juno.
You're my one and only Juno. The one and only Juno.
You're all the world to me.
Here is your eye, and wondering why.
pipe I'll smoke, cause I drive me moke. Are you there, Moriarty?
Come on in, Jackson boy, come on in.
Are you by yourself?
That don't matter now. I'm master here and I'll stay master now.
How do you feel now as a man of money?
Oh, it's a great responsibility, Jackson. A great responsibility.
I suppose it is, although you wouldn't think it.
Jackson, can you hand me over my attaché case? You know, I've hundreds of these documents to sign since the will come through every day. You don't know how hard it is.
All right, well, I won't disturb you. I'll drop in when...
No, stay, man. This is the last one today, yeah? So what is it I can do for you now, me man?
We just dropped in with £3.05 that Mrs. Madigan has on the blankets and the table for you. And she says you're to be in no hurry paying it back.
Well, tell her she won't be long without it. Here's £5 for yourself.
Oh, no.
Ah, go on, take it, man. We've been friends a long time. There'll be plenty more where that's coming from. Now and again, we have our different. We're together all the time.
Me for you, and you for me. Like the two musketeers.
You know, Father Farrell stopped me the other day and told me how glad he was that I fell into some money.
He'll be stopping you often enough now. I suppose it was Mr. Boyle with him.
He shook me by the hand.
Well, I met with Napper Tandy. He shook me by the hand.
Oh, you're seldom astray, Jockser, but you're a wrong ship this time.
Oh, you're after taking me up wrong, Captain. I wouldn't let a word be said against Father Farrell. The heart of the row, that's what he is. I've always said he was a darling man. A darling man.
You know, coming up the stairs, who did I meet? You know, that bummer Nugent, you know, the old grin in him. And he says to me, he'll be following you now like a guardian angel all the time with the old grin on him.
You know, I never once met him, but he didn't have that old grin on him.
Mr. Nugent, says I, Father Farrell is a man of the people. And as far as I know the history of me country, the clergy was always in the van for the fight for Ireland's freedom.
Who was it that led the van? Sagartaroo. When the fight first began, Sagartaroon.
Who are you telling, says he? Didn't they let down the fiends and then did they do in Parnell? I says, you ought to be ashamed of yourself, says I, interrupting him, not to know the history of your country. And I left him gawking where he was.
Where ignorance is bliss, 'tis folly to be wise. I wonder, did he ever read the story of Ireland?
B.J. L. Sullivan. Oh. Don't you know he didn't?
Oh, it's a darling buke, a darling buke.
You better be going now, His Majesty Mr. Bentham's coming any minute.
Oh, be the way things is looking, it'll be a match between Bentham and Mary. She seems to have thrown Jerry over altogether. Well, I hope it will, for he's a darling man.
Well, I don't think so. Well, what's darling about him?
Well, I only seen him twice. If you want to know me, come and live with me.
You know, he's too dignified for me. He thinks he knows more than Bonnie's oraculum. You know, he's given up his job as a teacher and he's going to become a solicitor in Dublin. Well, he's wrong shipped if he thinks I'm going to pay for it. And the other fellow, Jerry's, is bad. The two of them would give you a pain in your face. Jerry believing in nothing and Bentham believing in everything. One that thinks he's all God and no man. And the other thinks he's no man and all God.
Well, we'll be off now.
Well, don't forget to drop in after a while. We're having our entertainment, huh? And tell Mrs. Madigan she's always welcome for you to tell.
Never fear. I'll bring Mrs. Madigan with me.
Will you open the door, Jack? This thing's got me nearly killed with the weight of it.
That's a fine instrument.
Aye.
How much did that cost?
It cost £1 down and £5 to
paid at 2 shillings a week.
Oh, that's reasonable enough.
I'm awfully worried about the amount of debt we'll get into, Jack. I mean, first the new furniture, and now this.
The whole lot won't be much out of 2,000.
I don't know what you wanted a gramophone for. I know Charlie hates them. He says they're destructive of real music.
Destructive of music? You know that fella'd give you a pain in your face. All a gramophone needs is to be properly played. In true wonder, it's only felt when everyone's quiet. What a gramophone needs is silence. Dead silence.
Father, Jerry says the same. After all, you can only appreciate music when your ear is properly trained.
That's another fella to give you a pain in your face. Properly trained. I suppose you couldn't appreciate football unless your foot was properly trained.
Mary, go in our mat and get changed. Our Benton will be in on you and tea or nothing will be ready.
Tears and gramophones I'm thinking of.
Well, what is it you are thinking of, Alana?
Nothing.
Well, you must be thinking of something. It's yourself that has you the way you are. You can't get no rest spending one night in me sisters and the next night in your father's brothers and... Oh, yeah, you just don't get any rest going on that way.
I can get rest nowhere.
You're not trying to rest anywhere.
Will you let me alone? Will you let me alone, for God's sake?
Here he is. Here's Mr. Benton.
Well, there's room for him. Why don't we play him in with a brass band or something?
No, we'll hang around the tea. I will not be all clustered around the table as if we've not seen nothing. Mr. Benton! Hello, Mr. Benton. Do come in. Come and sit down here in the chair by the fire, and Mary will be out to you in a moment.
Mr. Benton, I seen that consols was down 0.5% this morning. You know, the whole world's getting into a terrible state of chassis.
What's consols, Jack?
Consols. Women wouldn't understand those things, consols.
It is just as you were saying, Mr. Boyle. Good evening, Mary. How pretty you're looking.
Am I?
We were just telling Mr. Benton, when you came in, Mary, that the whole world is in a terrible state of chassis.
Would you prefer the blue, green, ribbon rugby here, Charlie? Mary, your father's speaking.
I was just saying the whole world's in a terrible state of chassis.
I'm not sure you're threatened, though, whether it is or not. You know, look at the churches and the religions, and the world's not a bit better.
Look, Tay.
And Ireland's taken a leaf out of the world's book. And when we got the making of our own laws, I thought that we'd never stop to look behind us. But instead, we're never stopping to look before us. Oh, if people had followed up their religion better, there'd be a far better chance for us. What do you think, Mr. Benton?
I'm afraid I cannot venture to express an opinion on that point, Mrs. Boyle. Oh. Dogma has no attraction for me.
Oh, I'd forgotten that you didn't hold with us. What was it you said you were?
A theosophist, Mrs. Boyle.
A theosophist? And what in the name of God's a theosophist?
A theosophist, you know. What's a theosophist, Mr. Boyle?
Well, that's hard to explain in a few words. Theosophy is founded on the Vedas, the religious book of the East. Its central theme is the existence of an all-pervading spirit, the life breath. Nothing truly exists but this universal life breath, and whatever even seems to exist separately from it doesn't really exist at all. It is a vital force in all man, in all animals, and all vegetation. This life breath is called the prana.
What a comical name, the prana.
Yes, the prana. That is the prana.
Wish, Jack.
Well, the happiness of man depends on his sympathy with his spirit. Men who have reached a high state of excellence are called yogi. Some men become yogi in a short time. It may take others millions of years.
Yogi. I've seen hundreds of them down the streets of San Francisco.
It is said by these yogi that if we practice certain mental exercises, we would have powers denied to others. For instance, the faculty of seeing things that happen miles and miles away.
Oh, I wouldn't care to meddle with that sort of belief. It's a very, very curious religion altogether.
What's curious about it? Isn't all religion curious? If they weren't, you wouldn't get anyone to do it. But religion's passing away. You know, they've had their day, like everything else. The real Dublin people, for instance, know more about Charlie Chaplin and Tommy Mix than they do about St. Peter's and Paul.
You don't believe in ghosts, Mr. Bento?
Oh, my dear, don't you know he doesn't?
I don't know that, Mary. Scientists are beginning to believe that what we call ghosts are sometimes seen by a person of a certain nature. They say that sensational actions, such as the killing of a person, demand great energy, and that energy lingers to place where the action occurred. People may live in the place and never see a thing, when someone may come along whose personality has some peculiar connection with the energy of the place, and in a flash, the person sees the whole affair!
What sort of talk is this to be going on with? Is there nothing better to be talking about than the killing of people? My God, isn't it bad enough for these things to happen without talking about them?
I'm truly sorry, Mrs. Boyle.
It's all right, Mr.
Bender.
He's just a wee bit, he says.
Ah! Jesus! God! Shut the door, quick, for God's sake! Oh, great God, I'm going to die. Mother of God, shelter me, shelter your son!
Johnny, what ails you?
I seen him kneeling before the statue. Jesus, pity on me! Stay here, Mother. Stay here between me and the door.
Right.
Stay here as long as you need me. Come on, just tell me. What was it
that came across?
I seen him. I seen Robbie Tancred kneeling inside before the statue. Light shining on him. And when I went in, he turned around and looked at me. I saw the wounds bleeding in his breast. Why did he look at me like that? It wasn't my fault that he was done in. Jesus, keep him away from me.
There, child. It was all in your head. It was a red light that you'd seen. And then all the talk that we had, but all the rest of it into your head. It's just more of this. Are you good? Now, relax here. And Jack, go in and show him it was all in his own head.
It's all nonsense, only a shadow he saw or something.
Oh God, you made me heartless.
It was simply due to an overwrought imagination. We all get that way sometimes, right?
Now, get comfy there, and you'll be as bright as the nail in a few minutes.
Mother, run in and see if the light's lighting before the statue.
Jack, go in and see if the light's lighting before the statue.
Mary, go in there and see if the light's lighting before the statue.
It's all right, Mary. I'll go. Everything's just as it was. The light burning bravely before the statue.
Of course, I knew it was all nonsense.
Ah.
Hello, Mrs. Madigan.
Hello.
Jeez, Jackson, do some people know how to dress?
Fair as the blossoms that bloom in the May, and sweet as the scent of the new-born hay, and well may she wear.
And I know sonnets as sweeter than the blossoms that bloom in May. Naming no names, no pack drill.
Come in, Mrs. Madigan, and meet Mr. Bentham. Mr. Bentham, this is Mrs. Madigan, an old up-room neighbour that'd do a favour for anyone at any time.
I'm sure it's a pleasure to know you, Mrs. Madigan.
I'm going to tell you, Mr. Bentham, you're going to get as nice a bit of skirt in that Mary as ever you've seen in your puff. Not like some of these dressed-up dolls that's knocking around looking for men when what they really need is a good scalping. I remember as well as I remember yesterday, the day she was born of a Tuesday, on June the 25th in the year 1912. No, 1901. And it was very cold for the time of year, And I said to Joxer, who I met coming up the stairs, I said, that child of the chiseler of the Boyles will be a hardy chisel if it lived. And so, and she would be really be something that no one had the suspicion of. And so, signs on it, here she is today, about to be married to a young man, oh, who looks as if he could commensurate in any job God would please to call him.
Yes. Ah, come on, sit down, Mrs. Madigan, sit down. And this is Dr. Daly, an old friend of mine from the Shamrock branch of the National Foresters. He used to work there a long time. Him and me were often in a tight corner.
Aye.
A little desperado, Captain, a little desperado.
You're finding fully snug more often or not.
And we came out of it flying. We came out of it flying.
Indeed we did. Tay, Mrs. Madigan.
Thanks very much, Mr. Boyle, but I've just had me tea, and I'm afraid to drink any more. I'm not the same when I drink too much tea. Thanks all the same, Mr. Boyle.
Well, what about a bottle of stout? A drop in of whiskey?
A bottle of stout would be a bit heavy on me stomach after me tea. I'll try a ball of malt. There's nothing like a ball of malt. Occasional, like. Too much of it isn't a good thing. Ah, oh, Johnny, Dad, don't put too much water in it. Now, I suppose you'll believe in this place.
Yeah, I'm looking for a place by the sea. I'd like me grave, me cradle to be me grave. The sea has always been calling me. Would you have another drop of whiskey?
Well, seeing that the suspicious times it's in it, I can hardly refuse.
All right, we'll have a song from Juno and Mary.
Oh yes,
go on. Come on, order from the song.
Oh, it could be a daring song. A daring song.
No, I'm not in a singing queue.
Have you about to be married, child? Oh, I remember as well as I remember yesterday. Of a Tuesday, and a lovely August day, when me... Exactly 15th of the month, coming the Tuesday that's coming, following the next. When me old man, God rest his soul, and me was sitting shy together in a doughty little nook on a country road adjacent to the stiles. And he put up his hand to catch a hold of a dangling bramble bush, holding clusters of the loveliest flowers you ever seen. And catching hold of it, and letting his hand fall accidental like round me waist. And I felt it tightening and tightening and tightening. I thought me bosom was going to break out into a roistering song of the little green leaves of the shady trees, the gallivanting of the butterflies and the buzzing of the bees.
Order for the song.
Aye, okay, we'll do our best. Come on. There was an old woman of Carlo, in Carlo she did dwell. She dearly loved her husband and a gentleman twice as well.
Oh, fiddly idle oh, fiddly idle fiddly idle
oh, and wasn't she fond of him?
Well, the old man was so hearted, and sadly he did say, be God, I'll go and drive myself if you'll only lead the way.
With a fiddly idle oh, fiddly idle fiddly-idle-ay-ra,
oh, wasn't she fond of him?
Well, she brought him to the river, even to the brim, but cute enough he stepped aside, by God, she fell to him.
Oh, fiddly-idle-ay-ra, fiddly-idle-ay, fiddly-idle-ay-ra,
and wasn't she fond of him?
Oh, darling girls.
Juno.
Oh, very nice, rendered indeed.
A noble call, a noble call.
But what about yourself, Miss Madigan?
No.
Yes, go on. Come on.
If I were a blackbird, I'd whistle and sing. I'd follow the ship that my true love lies in. And on the top rigging, I'd there build my nest. And White Press. Hooray! Ah, me voice has gone hoarse now, Juno. I remember the time when Maisie Madigan could sing like a nightingale at mating time. Oh, I remember as well as I remember yesterday. It was at a party given to celebrate the coming of the first chiseller to Annie and Binnie Jimson, the barber, you know, in Henrietta Street. And after Easter week, he stuck out a pole with a green, white and orange flag. And then, when he heard the black and tans jazz dancing on the street, he whipped it in again and he put out a red, white and blue one, saying that a barber's pole was strictly non-political. Well, I was singing, and you'll remember me, with the top notes quivering in a dead hush of petrified attention, and followed by a clapping of hands that shook the tumblers on the table, and capped by Jimson saying it was the best rendering of I'll Remember Me I had ever heard in his whole life.
Oh. Order for Joxer, sir.
Oh, I couldn't cap. Don't ask.
Oh, go on, Joxer, go on.
Doctor, son, come on, what, give us one of your shut-eyed ones.
She is far from the land where her young hero sleeps, and lovers around her are sighing, and lovers around her are sighing, sighing, sighing.
And lovers around her are sighing. I hate people that can't finish the song and know the words of it.
Oh, try another one, Mr. Daly. Maybe you have more fortune.
Yes, try another one.
I have heard the mavis singing his love song to the morn. I have heard the dewdrop singing to the rose just newly born. To the rose just newly born, born, born.
Mother, will you put on the gramophone and stop Jock's just bawling, for God's sake?
Gramophone, you know, I hate to see fellas do what they can't do.
Wish Jack, don't put on the gramophone yet. Oh, this must be poor Mrs. Tancred coming down to go to the hospital. I forgot all about them bringing the body to the church tonight. Open the door, Mary, give them a bit of light.
Oh, it's a sad journey that we're all on. But God is good, and the Republicans won't always be down.
What good is that to me now? Whether they're up or down, it won't bring me boy back from grave.
Oh, come in, Mrs. Tancred, and have a hot cup of tea before you go.
I'll take nothing now, Mrs. Boyle. I won't be long after him.
Still and all, he died a noble death, and we'll bury him like a king.
And I'll go on living like a pauper. What the pains I suffered, bringing him into the world to carry him to his cradle, to the pains I'm suffering now, carrying him out of the world to bring him to his grave.
It'd be better for you not to go at all, Mrs. Tancred. Stay at home, beside a fire, with some of the neighbours.
I've seen the first of him, and I'll see the last of him.
Oh, you'll want a shawl, Miss Ma. I have a shawl. Oh, it's a cold night outside, and that wind's awful sharp.
My home's gone now. He was my only child. And to think, he was lying the whole night on a lonely country lane with his head, with his darling head that I'd often kissed and fondled, half hidden in the water of a running brook. And I'm told he was the leader of the ambush where my next door neighbour, Mrs. Manning, lost her Free State soldier son. And now here's the two of us old women, standing, one on each side of the scales of sorrow, balanced by the bodies of our two dead darling sons. God bless you, Mrs. Madigan. Mother of God, Mother of God, have pity on the pair of us. Blessed Virgin, where were you when my darling son was riddled with bullets? When my darling son was riddled with bullets? Sacred heart of the crucified Jesus, take away our hearts of stone and give us hearts of flesh. Take away this murdering hater. Give us thine own eternal love.
Yesterday, lying out beyond fingers, riddled with bullets. Oh, a diehard he was by all accounts. But he was a nice, quiet boy. But latterly he went to hell with his, you know, republic this and this republic that and republic overall. We often took tea with his here and in the old days, and Johnny there and him used to be always together.
Am I always to be having to tell you that he was no friend of mine? He could never stick me, and I never cared for him. It's not because he was commandant of the battalion I was quartermaster of that we were friends.
Well, he's gone now. The Lord be good to him, and God help his poor old creature of a mother. But no matter whose friend or enemy he was her poor son.
The whole thing is terrible, Mrs. Boyle. But the only way to deal with a mad dog is to destroy it.
Think of me forgetting about him being brought to the church tonight, and we singing and all. But it was good that we hadn't got the gramophone going.
Look, even if we had it set, we've nothing to do with these things. This is the government's business, and that's what we're paying them to do.
I'd like to know how a body's not to mind these things. I mean, look at the very way they're leaving all the people in this house. Hasn't the whole house nearly been massacred? I mean, there's young Doherty's husband with his leg blew off. There's Mrs. Travers with her son in a mine and in Chigila in County Cork. And Mrs. Manning that lost one of her sons in the ambush a few weeks ago, and now poor Mrs. Tancred's only child gone west and his body made a colander of. And sure, if it's not our business, I don't know whose business it is.
Look, here, there, that's enough about these things. They don't affect us and we needn't give a damn. You know, if they want a wake, let them have a wake. You know, when I was a sailor, I accepted a watery grave. If they want to be soldiers, leave them accept their soldier's fate.
Let me look a soldier far. Me heart expanding to the ball.
I suppose in one way she deserves all she got, for lately she let the diehards have the run of the house. And for the last couple of months, whether it was the sun rising or the sun setting, it was the CID coming in and bursting and asking where you were born, where you were christened, where you were married, and where were you going to be buried?
Oh, for God's sake! Let us have no more of this talk.
Well, why don't we have a song for Mr. Boyle before we start the gramophone?
Mother, Charlie and I are going out for a little stroll.
All right, darling.
You won't be long away, Mrs. Boyle.
Go on.
I want to have a few jars on me before I sing another.
Give us that poem you writ the other day. Oh, it's a darling poem. A darling poem.
Oh, God help us. He's starting to write poetry.
Sean and I were friends, sir. To me, he was all in all. His work was very heavy, his wages very small. 'Twas on the beach with Docker, I'll go babe. For now I'm feeling lonely, for today he lies in jail. He's not what some call pious, seldom at church or prayer. For many a scoundrel I know, sir, is every Sunday there. Fond of his pint, yet rather hated the boss by creed, but never refused a copper to a friend in need.
That was grand, that was grand. You should follow it up.
It's a daring poem.
Oh. He's going to put on the gramophone tonight, or he's not?
Yeah, go on, Jack, go on, put on a record.
Yeah, but you'll have to keep dead silent if I put it on. Okay, here we go. National regard for the day.
I think, Beadle Nugent, it's about time people started having a little less respect for the dead and a little more respect for the living.
We don't need you, Nugent, telling us what we already learned at our mother's knee. If you ask Maisie Madigan anything, I'd call you a real, true, die-hard, live-soft Republican, going to Republican funerals in the day, and stopping up half the night making suits for the civil guard.
Oh, wait though. Here's the hearse. Here's the hearse.
There's the old one walking behind it.
You can hardly see the coffin for all the wreaths.
Oh, it's a darling funeral. A darling funeral.
I think we'd get a better view from the street. Come on.
Yeah, I get the crack in my neck from here.
What?
Water, Master Boyle.
The mobiliser!
You're not at the funeral.
I'm not well.
Glad I found you. You were stopping at your aunt's. I called there, but you'd be gone. I have to give you an order to attend a battalion staff meeting the night after tomorrow.
Where?
I don't know. You're to meet me at the Peeler at 8 o'clock. Then we'll go to a place I'll be told of tonight. There we'll meet a motor that will bring us to the meeting. They think you might know something about them that gave the band where Common and Tankard was sheltering.
I'm not going then. I know nothing about Tankard.
You better come, for your own sake. Remember your oath?
Won't go. Boyle. Haven't I done enough for Ireland?
Boyle.
Lost my arm and my hips destroyed so I won't be able to walk right again. Haven't I done enough for Boyle. Ireland?
No man can do enough for Ireland.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women. Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Amen.
Long ago and not to wait till tonight.
There's no necessity. Pray, Mother, to go to the
a doctor. Nothing serious is wrong with me. I'm run down and squinted, that's all.
Oh, I don't like the look of you at all. We're not waiting.
I think we made a mistake in throwing over poor Jerry. It would have been better for you than that Bentham.
Wonder, the best man for a woman is the one for whom she has the most love. Charlie had it all.
Well, there's one thing to be said for him.
He can't have been after the money, otherwise he wouldn't have left you.
It must have been something else instead.
I don't know. I don't know, Mother. What do you think?
What do you think?
I imagine he thought we weren't good enough for him.
And what was he? Only a school teacher? Although I don't blame him for fighting shy of that old jocks or the old Madigan one. A nice type of people for your father to introduce to a man like Mr. Benton.
You might have told me.
Oh, but you might have told me about all of this earlier. I mean, I don't know why you like to keep things from your mother. You knew Mr. Benton, and I'd have known nothing about it if it hadn't been for the will.
It would have been useless to tell you. You wouldn't understand.
Maybe not. Maybe I wouldn't understand.
Mom, we'll go.
We're off now to the doctor's. Are you going to get up this evening?
Oh, the pains of my legs is terrible. Oh, there should be Venus going to the doctor instead of Mary, the way I feel.
Oh, Sara, mend you. A fine way you were in last night. Brought in a frog's march, dead to the world. If you go on like this, when we get the money, it'll be the grave for you, the asylum for me, and the poorhouse for Johnny.
Oh, I thought you were gone.
Well, that's what has you as you are. You can't bear to be spoken to. You know the way we are, up to our ears in debt. And I wonder that you wouldn't have got up to go to the solicitors to even ask if we could have got a little of the money.
Look, I can't be going up there morning, noon and morning, can I? He can't give money till he gets it, can he? Look, I can't get blood out of a turnip, can I?
True. This is true. However, you know that we owe old Murphy £20.
Oh, I've a faint recollection of you telling me that before.
Well, you'll go into the shop yourself in the future, because I'll not do it anymore.
Look, I thought you said you were going.
I'm going now.
Hey, Juno.
Aye, what is it?
Is there a bottle of stout left?
Aye, there's two left here.
Show us in one of them and leave the other there till I get up. And throw us in the paper that's on the table and the bottle of Sloan's liniment that's on the drawer.
Now, which paper do you want? The Catholic Herald.
Catholic Herald? No, the News of the World.
Oh. Now, mind that candle now. Don't burn the house down on top of this. Right, we're off now.
Me pipe, boiled smoke as I drive me monk. Are you there, Moriarty? My God, they must all be out. I was thinking there was something up, but he didn't answer the signal. We seen Juno and Mary going out. We didn't see him. And it's very seldom he escapes me.
He's not going to escape me. He's not going to be let go to this fair altogether.
Sure, the house couldn't hound him lately. And he gone around like a masterpiece of the Free State country. Forgetting their friends, forgetting God. Wouldn't even tip his hat past the chapel. So they were bound to get a drop.
And you really think they're not going to be getting any of the money? Not as much as a red rakes. Man, I've been a bit anxious this long time over me money. And I goes up to the solicitor's office to find out all I could. Ah, man, they were going to throw me down the stairs. They told me that the old cock himself had the stairs worn down coming after it.
and I'm all black in the face saying he'd get nothing. Somewhere or another, the will is writ that he's not entitled to so much as a meek.
I thought there was something curious about the whole thing. I've been having very strange dreams these last couple of weeks. And I noticed that Bentham fella don't seem to be coming here anymore. There must be something on the mat there too. Anyhow, who in the name of God is writing to that old bummer? Should it be unnatural? And the way him and Jew has been throwing their weight around it for the last few months. Him that goes a-borrowing, goes a-sorrowing.
Well, he's not going to be throwing his weight around in the suit I made for him much longer. 7 pounds aren't to be found growing on the bushes these days.
And there isn't hardly a neighbour in the whole street that hasn't lent him money on the strength of what he was going to get. Well, they're after backing the wrong horse. Wasn't it a mercy of God I had nothing to give him? Because softy that I am, we'd have given him me last juice. We must have had someone's prayers. After all, an honest man's the noblest of God's works. Where's Dad? He must be inside in bed.
Inside of bed or outside of it. He's going to pay me for that suit.
Go on in
it back.
Go on in at once and get it off, but don't be a fool.
Climb up my back as easy as he ticks. Mr. Boyle, don't disturb yourself. I hope you're not sick.
No legs, Mr. Nugent, no legs.
I just called round to see if you'd let me have anything off the suit.
Hey, how much is it that is?
Same as it was at the start, £7.
You know, I'm glad you came, Mr. Nugent. I want a good winter coat, Irish frieze if you have. How much would that be now?
About £6.
£6? Six and seven, 30. That'll be £13 I owe you.
You'll owe me no £13, Mr. Boyle. Maybe you better think you're able to owe it than to pay it.
Yeah, come back to hell, order. Where are you going with them clothes of mine?
Where am I going with them clothes of yours? I like your damn cheek.
Here, how am I going to dress myself when I go and out?
What do I care what you dress yourself in? You can put yourself in a bolster cover for all you like.
What'll he dress himself in? Gentleman Jack in his freeze coat.
Hey, Nugent! Nugent! Mr. Nugent! Hey, Nugent! Nugent!
What's up, Captain?
Nugent, he came in here and he took my suit, the only thing I had to go out in.
Took your suit? For God's sake. And what were you doing while he was taking him?
I was in the bed. He was in before. He was in like a thief in the night and he had gone off like a red shank.
And what in the name of God did he do that for?
Well, how do I know what he done that for?
Did he not say what he done it for?
Didn't I tell you? I was lying in the bed. He was just in and he took it.
That was a very sudden thing to do. There must be something behind it. Did he hear it, I wonder?
Hear anything? What would he hear? You talk very queer, Jack, sir.
Well, something about you not getting the money.
Who said I'm not getting money?
Well, that's just what I was thinking. Where did you get the money?
Oh, holy God!
What's up, Jack?
Yeah, he must have taken the bottle of stout that Juno left on the table for me.
Oh, I know. He wouldn't be after doing that now.
Well, hold on a minute. I hardly walked away by myself, did it?
Oh, that's shocking. Oh, man's inhumanity to man makes countless thousands mourn.
I hope I'm not disturbing you two in a discussion you may be having about your forthcoming legacy, if I may use the word. And I may have a couple of minutes barney with you, Mr. Boyle.
Come in, Mrs. Madigan. You're always welcome.
Come in the evening, come in the morning.
Yeah, I remember it well. I have it down here in my book. £3, 5 shillings from Maisie Madigan, raised on articles pawned. An item, 4 pence given to make up the price of a pint, on the principle that no board ever flew on one nest. All to be repaid when the ship comes home.
Well, since I shoved in the blankets, I've been perishing with the cold. And if I'm to be too cold hot in the next world, I'm not going to be too cold in this one. And consequently, I want me £3, if you please.
This is a very sudden demand, Mrs. Madigan, and can't be met. But I'll give you a receipt to the value in full.
Well, give me the money now, and don't be Jack Acton.
Well, you can't get blood out of a turnip, can you?
Give me the money, you reprobate, or I'll shake it out of you.
Hey, hold on now, Miss. Hold on no. Me lassie, I can't have no money to give you.
So I'll go without me cash, will I? Well, we'll see about that. If I can't get me cash, I'll take the worth of it.
Oh. Hey, you can't take that.
Well, why not? I'm going to pawn it and I'll bring you the ticket. And then you can do what you like with it, me boyo.
Well, it's not even mine. It's not even paid for yet.
So much the better. It'll ease me conscience, for I'm taking what doesn't belong to you. You're not going to be swanking it like a peacock with Maisie Madigan's money. Oh no, I'll pull some of the gorgeous feathers out of your tail, me bucko.
Shucks, there's no morality left in the world anymore.
Well, you wouldn't have believed it, only we've seen it with me own two eyes. I didn't think Maisie Madigan was that sort of a woman. She must either have a drop taken, or she's heard something.
Heard something? What are you saying?
She heard some rumour the other day you weren't going to get the money.
Who says I'm not going to get the money?
Sure, I don't know. I was only saying.
Only saying what?
Nothing.
Out with it. Don't be a twister.
Who's a twister?
Well, why don't you speak your mind then?
Oh, you've never twisted yourself. You wouldn't know how.
Did you ever know me to twist? Did you ever know me to twist?
Did you ever do anything else? So you can't believe a word that comes out of your mouth.
Ah, get out of here. You're just a prognosticator and a provocator.
Say au revoir, farewell, Jackie Boyle, Esquire, infernal rogue and damned liar.
Jocks are new at it again, eh?
Are you going to lecture me now?
Mother back from the doctor yet with Mary.
Well, what happened with Mary?
Come and sit down, Jack. I've got something to tell you. It's about Mary.
About Mary?
Aye, come and sit down.
More trouble in our native land. Well, what about her?
Well, it's about Mary.
What's wrong with her?
I'm sorry to say there's a cradle wrong with her.
A cradle wrong with her? First Johnny, and now Mary. The place is like a hospital. It's not consumption, is it?
No. It's not consumption. It's worse.
Worse? Well, we'll have to get her into some place over this. There's no one here to mind her.
Well, we're all going to have to mind her now. You might as well find out now, Johnny, as later on. Jack, do you know what the doctor said to me about her?
How would I know? I wasn't there, was I?
He told me to get her married at once.
Married at once? What did he say that for?
Because in a short time, Mary's going to have a baby.
Have a baby? You wait till Benton hears about this.
Oh, you blind man. You can't see that it was Benton that has done this wrong to her.
Oh, he'll have to marry her. He'll have to marry her.
Do you know he's gone to England? And God knows where he is now.
Oh, I'll follow him. I'll follow him and bring him back. Oh, I might have known. The scoundrel with all his yogis and his prawners.
Shh. We just need to keep it quiet until we can see what we can do.
Oh, isn't this a nice thing to come and chop me in the state I'm in? A pretty show I'll be to Jotzer and to that old one Madigan. Oh, haven't I after going through enough without having to go through all this?
Oh, what you and I'll have to go through will be nothing compared to what Mary has to go through. But for you and I is middling old and most of our years is spent. But poor Mary's got maybe 40 years to face and every single one of them will be tainted with a bitter memory.
Where is she? Where is she till I tell her off? I'm telling you, when I'm done with her, she'll be a sorry girl.
I left her at my sister's till I came to speak to you. You'll say nothing to her, Jack. Ever since she left school, she's earned her living and your fatherly care hasn't troubled her.
Go on, take her part again, her father. But I'll let you see whether I'll say nothing to her or not. Horror or reading, that's more of that blasted nonsense that brought the house down on us. What is it like her born in a tenement house one with her reading? Oh, her reading's after bringing us that fine pass. Oh, it's maddening. Maddening. Maddening.
When she comes back to this place, say nothing to her, Jack, or she'll leave it.
Leave this place? Aye, she will leave this place. And quick, too.
And if Mary leaves, I'll go, too.
Oh, well, go with her. Well, go, the pair of yous. I've lived before yous, and I can live when yours are gone. Isn't this a nice thing to come rolling top of me with all your praying to St. Anthony and the little flower? And she a child of Mary, too. I wonder what the nuns will think of her now. And it'll be bellowed all over the district before you can say Jack Robinson. And whenever I'm seen, they'll whisper, that's the father of Mary Boyle that went off with the swank. Oh, you know. They'll know before I'll know.
She should be driven out of this house. She's brought disgrace on.
Oh, hush you, Johnny. We don't need to let it be bellowed out all over the place. All we need to do is leave this place quietly, go somewhere where we're not known, and nobody will be the wiser.
You're talking like a two-year-old woman. Where do we get a place? Places aren't that easy to come by.
But Jack, when we get the money, we'll be able to...
Money? What money?
Why, old Ellison's money.
There's no money coming from old Ellison. Or anyone else. Since you've heard of one trouble, you might as well heard of another one. There's no money coming to us at all.
What are you
saying? The will's a washout.
What are you saying, man? No money?
Happen to be a washout?
The boy that's after doing it to Mary is after doing it to us. The tick made out the will wrong. He said in the will, only first cousin and second cousin, instead of mentioning our names, and now everyone thinks that he's a first and second cousin of all Ellison. They can claim the money and they're springing up into hundreds from America and Australia, thinking to get their whack out of it, while all the time the liars is gobbling it up and there isn't even a little present to buy for your little darling baby's daughter.
I don't believe it.
Why did you say nothing about this before?
You can't be serious, Jack. You cannot be serious.
I'm telling you, the scholar Bentham made out the will wrong. Instead of saying the rest of my property to me first cousin Jack Boyle and me second cousin Mick Finnegan of Santry, he said just me first and second cousin, and now everyone's claiming everything and there's nothing left.
And you let us run into debt, and you borrowed money from everybody to fill yourself with beer, and now you're saying the whole thing's a washout?
Oh, you hold your tongue, do you hear? If you want to go after someone, go after Bentham because he's the cause of it all.
Not hold me tongue. I'll tell you what I think of you. Father,
you're not. Johnny, for God's sake.
No, I won't be quiet. Listen to me, you.
No, Johnny, for your mother's sake. Your mother's sake, stop.
Shit. Well, I think I'll go out for a drink with the last few makes I've got. Well, and you tell that daughter of mine, if I lay my eyes on her, I lay my hands on her. And if I lay me hands on her, I won't be accountable for me actions.
Take care nobody lays his hands on you, you prick.
Johnny.
A nice son and a nicer daughter I have. Jock, sir, are you there?
I'm here, Moriarty.
You want to go down to Foley's?
Come with you. If that sweet call, me heart is stored. And I'll be with you. No.
With a nice father and a nice sister, there's no betting on it. I wish to God a bomb or a bullet had whipped me out of this long ago. Not one of yous is a single thought for me.
If you don't wish, Johnny, you will drive me mad. Oh, who's had to keep the home together for the past years? Only me. And who's going to have most of the troubles to bear out of this? Me. But whinging and whining isn't going to help any.
You're to blame for a great love of yourself. Giving him his own way in everything. Never stopping to ask him what he was doing, no matter what he done. Why didn't you look after the money? Huh?
Don't you dare speak to him.
We've been sent up by the Hibernian Furnishing Company to take back some things that you had a while ago.
You'll take nothing from here. How do I know whose you are?
Oh, here's the order, Miss is boiled. A couple of tables, chairs, clock, a couple of vases. Come on, Bill, it's almost knocking off time already.
Well, there runs down to follies and get Father back, and we'll be left without a stick.
What use would that be? You heard what he said.
Can't you try? You ought to be hearing the like of this going on anyway.
After all,
everything's gone wrong, Mary. Everything. We're not getting a penny from the will, not a penny. I'll tell you all about it. I'm going to fetch your father.
It's a wonder you're not ashamed to show your face around here after what's happened.
Mary. Mary, I want to speak to you for a few moments. May I? Your mother told me everything. And I've come to tell you. I've come to tell you, Mary, that my love for you is greater and deeper than ever.
Terry, Terry, say no more.
Impossible. Why do you talk like that, Mary?
After all that happened.
What's the matter what happened? Mary, I'm pleading for your love. With labour, Mary. Humanity is above everything. But the leaders in the fight for the new life. I won't forget Bentham. I won't forget that you left me. Been for a while.
Jerry, you haven't been so rid of scorn for me after all.
Scorn! I love you. Love you, Mary.
You mean dog?
Even though you threw me over for another man. Even though you gave me much a bit of widow scorn.
Yes, but you love me. You love me. Even though I'm going. I was thinking so. You don't know everything.
What God? Mary, you don't mean that.
No, you know, Terry. Now we know all.
Show me the God. Have you fallen as low as that, Mary?
Yes, Terry! As you say! I've fallen as low as that.
I'm sorry. I didn't mind what I was saying. It just came on me so sudden. Your mother never told me. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for you, Mary.
Just say no more. I don't blame you for thinking I was terrible. I suppose it is. And everybody will think the same. It's only as I expected. Your humanity. Just as narrow as humanity of others.
Sorry, all the same. I shouldn't have come. I wouldn't if I'd known. I can do anything for you, Mary. I will.
Yes.
I'm sorry, miss, but we can't wait any longer for the old fellow. Says we have to get on.
Oh, isn't this terrible? Suppose you told him everything. Couldn't you have waited a while? He might have stopped the taking of the things if you kept your mouth shut. Are you burning to tell everyone of the disgrace you brought on us?
This is unbearable.
Mother of God, the light's after going out!
Hey, come on, you give me a fright talking like that.
What's the matter with you?
Oh, mother of God, that's a shot I'm after getting!
Well, is it a fit you'd be having?
After feeling the tearing in my breast like the rubber bite of a bullet.
He's gone mad. He's gone mad. It's a sin. People shouldn't leave a boy like that alone. It's all house.
What? What you doing here?
Oh,
quick!
We're just taking some furniture that haven't
yeah,
been
yeah,
paid
get
off
to the other side of the room. Turn your fists to the wall. Quick!
Sean Boyle. You're wanted. Some of us have a word to say to you.
I'm sick. I can't. What do you want with me?
We have a distance to go. We haven't much time. Come on.
My old comrade. He's wouldn't shoot an old comrade.
Poor Dankert was an old comrade. But you didn't think of that when you gave him away to the gang that's in your disgrace. Come on now. We haven't much time. Here, Cameron, catch his arm. And you, your beads.
Your beads. Why'd you ask me that?
Come on, boy, march!
March! Are you gonna do it or no, comrades?